Good evening, madam, and thank you so
much. Good evening.
For joining me this evening for this conversation. Thank you.
My pleasure.
You retired in between this lockdown period.
Yes.
And you have been very busy in reading hundreds of files daily and complete. Yeah. Now you are at rest. So how, which period you are enjoying, the busy one or this one?
Actually, I feel that all of you are in the same, sailing in the same boat as I am. Because I retired during the corona thing and till the last day I had to work a lot because I had to finish all my judgments. You people were free even before that.
Right.
So actually, I think the feeling would be the same as you have. And it's nice. I feel relaxed. All my work is over. No pending cases. I couldn't sleep properly because the cases were pending. Now I'm able to sleep peacefully.
True, madam. You have dealt with varieties of subjects during your JATSIF, right? From difficult criminal trials to complicated tax issues.
Yes.
How could you deal with such diverse subjects? And is there any common thread between this subject?
See, common thread is, I don't know, but after I learned taxation, because taxation was a totally new subject for me.
Yes.
I learned it only after I became a judge. But somehow learning tax was something which made everything else easy.
Right.
So I believe I could deal with criminal cases more easily because of what I learned in taxation. I don't know, the foundation became so, there was such a good foundation of everything that right. It made it easier. Or maybe tax is so difficult that everything else becomes easy. But one common thread is, of course, hard work and going into depth of each matter and meticulously reading all the facts.
Right, madam.
That's one thing I take care of in every matter, be it small or big, is to meticulously read all the facts and the law. So that is what makes it easier to deal with all these subjects. So it makes no difference which subject you are dealing with, as long as you have a grip on the facts and the law. That is all.
Right, madam. How were your childhood days and what do you carry along from your childhood days till now?
See, in my childhood days, initially, my father was a civil engineer and he took work with the military engineering services. So it took him all over the country. So initial years I spent in Ranchi, which was then part of Bihar, and I went to a school called Loreto Convent. So yeah, and then in the school, though I was there only till the second standard, but we had a period called library period. So they used to give us library books.
Okay.
And I started reading the moment I learned reading. I started reading books. So I used to read my own textbooks. I used to read my sister's books. I used to read my cousin's books. Mm-hmm. And I read all the library books that they gave me.
Right.
And since childhood, after that, we went to Assam, a place called Dibrugarh, where I got introduced to other books like Enid Blyton and all those other books. And then later on, of course, graduated to other, classics and everything, Lewis I. Alcott and Jane Eyre and all those books.
Right.
But those books all ultimately... are those which, sort of your build your character and lay down the foundation of what you are ultimately. Reading, I think, is the main thing which in my childhood I inculcated.
Right.
So,
but since madam, you have studied outside Gujarat during your childhood days, how could you cope up with reading and writing Gujarati language?
No, but see, I'm a Gujarati. So, at home we did speak Gujarati and then when we came to Ahmedabad, I was in the 8th standard, around 14 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And for 1 year, we had Gujarati as a subject.
Mm-hmm.
And since I was very fond of reading, when we were in Dibrugarh, my father had got us a lot of Gujarati books with Ka Kha Ga Gha.
Oh.
So, when you know Hindi and when you know the language, you can easily learn it. So, I learned reading Gujarati on my own even before I came to Gujarat. So, I could read that. And then, of course, after I joined this profession, I had to do a lot of Gujarati reading. And somehow, over a period of time, get a grip over the same language also.
Madam, what was your motivation to choose the profession?
Actually, see, basically, there was no motivation as such. I was a housewife. I had done my MSc in microbiology initially. And then I was married. I got married in 1981. Those days, the family that I came from, one would not dream of a daughter going out and working or anything of that kind.
Right.
Or any profession or anything. But when my son was around in the first standard, my younger brother had passed his engineering. And I happened to be at my father's place and my father was advising him that you should do your LLB. because knowledge of law is important in life. Incidentally, I happened to be there. So I said, even I'll join law college with you. So I asked him to get a form for me. And that was 8 years after my post-graduation that I joined law college in 1989 with my brother. I was too shy to go and get a form on my own or to go to college on my own. But then I went with him. Of course, he didn't complete it then. Cool. But I went to law college. Most of my colleagues were 10 years younger than me. But then I did complete it. And then when I was in the second year, after I had completed my second year in the vacation, one of my neighbors, she was a small-time tax practitioner. She told me that since you're studying law, why don't you come with me? I mean, to the courts and everything. So I told my father about it. So he said, why go with her? You should go with Mr. Krishnakant Vakharia. So he immediately called him up. And Mr. Vakharia said, send her over. So I said, should I straight away go to the High Court or should I go to other courts? So he sent me to one Miss Maya Bhavnani. So I went to the city civil courts and all the Mirzapur courts, all other courts with her. And I found that courts are a respectable place and a place where I could go to and I could, in fact, have a profession. Even when I was studying law, I never intended to practice or anything. But once I went to the courts, I got interested in it. And that is how, after I finished my third LLB, I joined Mr. Vakharia and started practicing.
Right, madam. What do you suggest the students who will be now passing law, whether they should start their practice from trial court level or if they can at all willing to start from High Court or Supreme Court, it would be advisable?
See, it's quite okay when starting from the High Court. We have many advocates who have done, I mean, practiced only in the, started practicing in the High Court. But knowledge of civil law and the trial courts is also important because ultimately, unless you have those basic foundation there, you can't. You would not be in a position to handle civil matters here. But even without going to the courts, if you really look into the law, you can still pick it up even without going to the courts. I mean, the basically, when you at the High Court level, you need to go in. I mean, you are dealing with appeals and all those things. So if you learn the law properly, like Civil Procedure Code and all those things, you have to master them on your own, read judgments and everything. So not necessary that you go there, but it's always better to have a background. I mean, having gone to the trial courts for a little while is always good. Maybe a year or so is sufficient, but at least one should go, maybe.
Right. So there are two theories in present education system. One is that they are imparting all sorts of new enactments which are coming into place. That is IBCs, competitions, they deal with merger and acquisitions and all other subjects. And they do not actually concentrate on the base, on the basics law, that is CPC, CRPC, evidence, contract, constitution, etc. And another theory is that they must learn other subjects and they will learn these basic subjects along with their practice. So which theory you support the most? Whether they shall go ahead with all these subjects or they shall more concentrate on the basics?
Even when we studied in law, I mean, I think we studied all subjects together. I don't find any concentration on any basic subjects, even when we were studying in law. And ultimately, Civil Procedure Code, Evidence and Act and everything, I mean, it's practical learning which is more important, you know. At that stage, you actually realize just reading those provisions, and when you actually apply them to a case, you understand them better. Like when I was dealing with the Naroda Patia case and the Sardarpura riot cases, I found that most people were not aware of basic provisions of Criminal Procedure Code and Evidence Act, like Section 161, 162, the scope of those sections. I found that everywhere, I mean, there was a breach of those provisions, Section 145 of the Evidence Act. Many of those provisions. In fact, even I was not conversant with those provisions. Mm-hmm. I taught myself only in those matters. So, ultimately.
You have been very modest, madam. But in that Naroda Patia, you went for the site visit as well, the place of... That was much appreciated by the legal fraternity all around. Hardly any high court.
See, visiting the site was more because the advocates thought that we would not be able to appreciate the evidence better.
Right.
I mean, properly, unless we actually had a visit of the site. That was a suggestion from all the advocates, the public prosecutors as well as the advocates for the other side. So we just respected the wishes and we went there. And of course, it made a difference because the manner in which the site was situated, maybe just reading the evidence, we would not have been able to envisage the correct position properly.
Such complicated matter, right, madam? What changes you propose to be made in the?
I don't know. I think the present legal situation, I mean, seems to be pretty good because I realized that when we were studying LLB and when we came to the court, the kind of understanding that we had of law, I find that the students these days are far better and much more well-versed. My niece was only in the first year LLB, and she was preparing for a moot court competition, and she asked me for some help. Mm-hmm. And the manner in which she could grasp the subject, I doubt if I would have been able to grasp it so well even after my third year. So possibly the education now is better, in fact. I mean, they're better equipped to understand everything.
Right.
So I don't think, at least I'm in a position to suggest any changes in that present education.
Right. Now, what is the most striking quality that you can tell us about Krishnakant Vakharia, sir, and which you inculcate within you?
See, as a senior, he took care of his juniors. So the moment we joined, and any of us juniors joined, he would give us a stipend. Mm-hmm. Those days, we had other colleagues also who were practicing in the High Court, and we found that their seniors never gave them anything, and they had to just come to the court, and they were not earning anything, and we were given a stipend. He was one senior who permitted us to sit in his chamber.
Mm-hmm.
So we could sit in his chamber at any point of time. If any client has come, we could sit there, see him take instructions. And since he was a senior advocate, he could not normally dictate any matters or anything, because he could only settle them. But once in a while, only for our benefit, he would dictate something,
mm-hmm.
call us to his chamber so that we could sit and we could understand. And when he took instructions, we were sitting there. Every day after we came from the court, we would all be sitting in his chamber. He would talk to us. He would discuss the day-to-day cases. And he told us that we are running a school.
Mm-hmm.
So that is how his entire approach was. And he used to actually teach us and talk about many things, not just law, but other things also. And I think that is something most of us told, that none of the seniors do that.
Right.
Permitting them to sit in the chamber, talking about all these things. And another thing about him was that you don't just go and ask him something you don't understand. First, you try on your own. You study the subject, look at the law. And if ultimately you don't understand, you go and tell him that, please, I've been trying to do it, but I could not understand. And then he would explain. But otherwise, unless you do it on your own. And another thing is, when you prepare a case, you prepare it so thoroughly that you have to be ready with any question that the court might ask. So suppose it's a civil matter,
mm-hmm.
and an FIR, and in that civil matter, there's something which says that an FIR has been filed against that person.
Right.
So we would look into the FIR, look at the sections, read each and every section in that FIR, which might not be very relevant.
True.
But you have to understand everything and prepare everything thoroughly. So you anticipate any query and be ready with it. So right. I think it's that kind of... going into the depth of every matter.
Right. Madam, when have you appeared first time before the court on your own legs, and were you nervous then?
I was very nervous. In fact, when I was mentioning in some court, I remember Justice Vaid telling me, why are you trembling so much? I mean, so I was a very nervous kind of person, and at the age which I came in and practice also, I was 34 when I started practice. So, and I was a very shy person. I was not somebody anybody would associate with the legal profession, basically. So anyway, I came here and changed me totally.
Right. So what have you done to overcome that nervousness, madam? Because that is what even...
I think you overcome over a period of time, I think, on its own. I mean, maybe sometimes the courts are so encouraging also, it helps.
Right.
Like initially, one day I was just sitting in the court of Justice Divechaya. I was a newcomer. Sitting his court, I must have mentioned something the earlier day. So he asked me, he said, are you a non-Gujarati? I said, no. Then he says, no, yesterday you spoke a little in my court, but what little you spoke very well. So I thought you were a non-Gujarati. So I said, no, I'm not a non-Gujarati, but I've studied outside Gujarat. And then he used to encourage me so much. So maybe it's that kind of encouragement that you get, that you overcome the initial nervousness. But it took me a long time to get over the nervousness.
Any specific matter that you recollect which you can say to be a milestone in your professional career, or which has actually transposed your attitude in the legal profession?
Matter, I don't think I recall any such matter, because as a judge, yes, after I became a judge, when I was handling taxation, so that was of course a different thing, that turning point of my this thing life, maybe dealing with tax. But otherwise, any case as an assistant, because I was mostly an assistant. I worked as an assistant government pleader only.
Mm-hmm.
So I handled a lot of cases there, but I can't recall any such case which I would say that this thing.
what judges usually expect from advocates, and what preparations that advocate are required to do when they appear before the courts?
It's not only just when you appear before the court that you have to prepare. You have to prepare before you file a case.
True.
So initially you have to start with your pleadings.
True.
So when you draft a matter, you have to first be careful that you get all your facts correct.
Right.
Then the grounds which you have laid down, I mean set out in your petition or in your memo of appeal are properly, I mean you have raised proper grounds.
Right.
So if you lay down the facts and the foundation in your petition, maybe you don't have to argue much.
Right.
Because if the judge reads and comes, most of your work is already done. So if you have a well drafted petition with all your grounds set out therein, maybe you don't have to make many submissions. Before you come to the court, you have to read the entire case properly,
right,
thoroughly, with the law.
Right.
So first thing is you have to master the facts, then the law, and then the decisions. These days we find it's the reverse. They come with the decisions, then the law and the facts. At the last, and when you ask them the facts, they're flabbergasted. What is she asking? I mean, my facts. But unless it's the facts, how do we understand what your case is? So
right,
the facts are the most important. And if you know the facts, I think sometimes the judges would take care of the law themselves.
True.
So preparation is, I mean, being thoroughly prepared means with every aspect of the matter.
Mm-hmm. So. Right. Does any specific changes in the quality of advocates that you suggest in the preparation or in any other manner that you suggest?
Preparation, that is what I'm saying. First of all, you have to be very thoroughly prepared. Then the manner in which you present the matter before the court. So if it's a final hearing matter, you have to argue it thoroughly. You have to go right from the facts. These days, we often see that they start with the law. So you start first with the facts, lay down the foundation of your case, and then you go to the law. And one thing is, don't just pile up judgments. You go to find out which is a decision, which properly applies to your case. These days, I mean, it's so easy to get decisions from the online, from the software, which is so easily available, that they just cite any 5, 20, 25 cases without looking at the one which is exactly applicable to their own case. So first of all, find out which is exactly applicable to you. You can cite only those judgments.
Mm-hmm.
And cite the leading judgment of the Supreme Court, the initial one and the latest one. So
right,
two judgments are enough. And suppose something is slightly different and applies to your case, so cite that judgment. But then all kinds of judgments are cited. Sometimes they just cite an order.
Mm-hmm.
I remember when I was taking up caution, somebody gives me a 4-line order,
mm-hmm,
where it was held that his name is not there in the FIR, not mentioned in the FIR, therefore complaint is quashed. So they point out binding judgment of the court.
Mm-hmm.
So do they even understand the basic proposition of law as to what is a binding judgment? A binding judgment is something that lays down a proposition of law, not an order. But I mean, in so many cases we find these days, and a judgment on facts is cited, that on identical facts the court has given relief. But facts don't make up, facts are not a precedent. It's the law laid down or the ratio decidendi of a case which is relevant. But that, I mean, people don't bother. And mostly I find that advocates read the head notes.
Mm-hmm.
Only. So yeah, unless you read the judgment, you don't understand what is actually there. So sometimes pretty often find that they have cited a judgment which actually is against them.
Mm.
Because they have only looked at the head notes. And when you read the judgment properly, you might find that there are many things against them in the very same judgment. So unless you properly read a judgment, and it's the judgments, actually, basically, I believe I learned law from judgments.
Right.
So when I come across a case, and if I have to cite a judgment, I would read the entire judgment thoroughly. So when you read a judgment properly, you get clarity of thought as well as of the law. So
right,
by doing that, you not only assess the court, but you also improve yourself.
Right.
And then subsequently, when you come across a similar case, you'll remember the judgment so well because you have read it thoroughly.
Right.
So it saves.
Madam, when you used to read matters by your own before, yes, going to court, you must have sometimes felt that there is no merit in the matter. And then how do you deal with such matters in the court?
See, thankfully for me, I was with Mr. Vakharia for slightly less than 3 years. Thereafter, I became an assistant government pleader. And in the government pleader's office, you can always afford to be fair.
Right.
So if it's a weak case, you need not fight it.
True.
You can always concede that no, the other side has a good case and you may not. So that, I think that was my approach, that there was a weak advocate opposing me and I could have convinced the court otherwise. And the other side might have lost. But if he had a good case, I would not fight it. I mean, as a government, being
right,
on the government side, I would not like to win a wrong case.
Right. The question is, madam, as a judge, you must have fined before going to court. There is no merits. And then, how do you deal with such situation or such matter?
You dismiss it. If the case has no merit, to dismiss it at the threshold.
Right.
As a judge, you only have to decide and see whether there's merit or not. If there's no merit in the case, there are so many cases which you dismiss at the threshold because we find no merit in the case.
True, but
see, suppose I when I read a case, I don't find any merit in it, I would still hear the advocate.
That's
when I go, I would have made up my mind that no, there's no merit in this case. But right. Then I would hear the advocate. Then sometimes it happens that though you find there's no merit in the case, he can convince you otherwise. Really? And if he convinces me otherwise, of course, then I would issue notice and hear the other side. Really? Not that just because when I read the matter, I found no merit, I would dismiss it. And I would just stick to the view which I found when I read the matter. Right. So ultimately, it's after hearing the advocate who can convince you.
Mm-hmm. Right. And what are your other hobbies other than this profession?
Hobbies. I joined the profession, there was no time for hobbies, actually. So all I have done for all these years is only work because there was no time for hobbies. Earlier, I used to draw and paint and all those things, But now, of course, over all these years, and reading was my main hobby because I was a shy person. I used to read a lot. So not those heavy books or anything, but bestsellers, right from, Enid Blyton. Then you go to those Earl Stanley Gardner, Perry Mason and all those. Then I used to read Westerns also. So I used to read a lot, and it's that reading which I had in the past which helped me because I had at least a reasonably good vocabulary when I joined the profession. So that helped me. Because it is easier to express myself and the pleadings, etc. It was easier to draft.
What are your now future post-retirement plans? Coming back to practice in Supreme Courts or?
Practice, I don't know whether, since I was always only an assistant government pleader, I have not had any independent practice. I don't know how well I would be able to adjust to that. But of course, it's still an option. Practicing in the Supreme Court is an option. And one thing is clear, I'm not taking up any assignment, government assignment, no commissions or any appointment like that. So I'm open to arbitration and practicing, of course. But let's see how it works out. Retirement in the corona period doesn't leave anything for the time being. No immediate plans, of course.
Right. Any message that you would like to give to the legal fraternity at large to remain positive during this lockdown period?
See, lockdown period, one can use for doing things that one could not do while in practice. Traveling and all those things. But see, every day you have so many cases to handle. Yeah. So you are not able to concentrate on a particular case. Now, suppose like you, I see you seem to be in your office or something. Yeah. So if you have access to your office, then you have your files with you. True. So work out the files which you are ultimately going to deal with. Yeah. So if you start working out those cases, and then, you work out the cases and put notes in every matter. So when after the courts reopen and then you have to deal with that case, you would save yourself time because you've already worked out the case. All you have to do is take out your notes and then you're able to do it easily. Then this is the time to read judgments, which you don't get the time normally to read. Complete judgments, the ones which you had said that someday you will read them.
Right.
And for those who are practicing in a specialized field, all you have to do is download all judgments. That in that field, and you can master yourself. Mastering one subject is very easy.
Correct.
Because then all you have to do is read judgments in that field. And one thing that my senior used to tell us for juniors when we joined, he says, unless you have worked out 100 cases, you should not start appearing in the court. So in the senior's office, you just take out cases, read them, work them out. Work out means you read the petition, right. You read the affidavit in reply. So read the petition, find out what the case of the petitioner is. Read the affidavit in reply, find out what the case of the respondent is. Then find out, weigh the balance, see who appears to be right. Look at the law and look at the judgments. And that is how you work out a case. So he used to tell us that appearing in matters has to just work out matters. And when you work out matters, you teach yourself.
Very true.
And one more thing let me tell you is that I have learned more from sitting in the court than actually the matters which I have conducted. Since I was an assistant government pleader, I was assigned particular courts. Right. So I used to sit in the courts throughout the day.
Right.
So any matter which is going on, I would hear it. So somebody, suppose Mr. Kirtika Nanavat is arguing against some senior advocate, two senior advocates. I would hear them. So you come to know what is the issue involved. Then since you're in the same court, the next time the matter comes up, you know where they had stopped. So, and then there's so many things you learn from the discussion that goes on between the court and the learned advocate. If you remember Chief Justice D.S. Sinha,
mm-hmm.
I was assigned I was assigned in his court. So his he would say that your job is the most onerous, the assistant government leaders, because you have to assist me in every matter.
Right.
So any matter which goes on in the court, I have to pay attention. Whether I am in that matter, it might be a totally matter where the government is not a party. But I had to hear their arguments, and he would make me stand up anytime and ask me a query, and I was supposed to reply those queries. So, you know, those things teach you a lot more. And sitting in the court, you watch advocates make submissions, you see, then you can make out the difference between who is, arguing a matter better. You learn court manners. One thing which is lacking these days is court manners.
Right.
That Mr. is often lacking, you know, when they name somebody, they just give the name, so-and-so is appearing without that Mr. there.
Correct.
Then there's a lot of infighting, bickering between the advocates. My learned friend may not say this, my learned friend may not that. What, are we your parents? That we have to tell you what to do.
Right.
So that kind of behavior, etc., are things which could be avoided by advocates. And one thing is, there's no substitute for hard work.
Very
it's good. Only hard work that matters. And if you want to succeed in any field, you have to be two steps ahead of others.
Right, ma'am.
So whatever... effort others put in, you have to put in more effort if you want to be more successful. So that is exactly what you have to do.
Madam, you said this is that work of the AGP was difficult than what work that judges do. What do you actually found? Which one was difficult for you? AGP work? Or?
It's more difficult as a judge, because deciding is very difficult. See, working as an assistant government leader, you had to, all right, study matters and you file your reply. But ultimately, it's the judge who has to decide. So whether advocates put in proper arguments or not, if I have to do justice, I have to read the cases myself and see into it that, see, sometimes they're very weak. When I was taking up quashing, there'll be an advocate who's got a very strong case, but the advocate is weak. Now, merely because he can't make submissions properly doesn't mean that he should lose a good case. So then it's the duty of the judge. Sometimes there are so many advocates who just come and say, my lords may pass appropriate orders. So what does it mean? That you read the matter, you decide it. So ultimately, it's that, judging is quite tough, because you have to be, you have to read everything thoroughly. Like, say, you may not read the facts correctly, but before I decide a case, I have to be, at least I have to read the facts minutely to see that I give a correct judgment. So I think judging is much more difficult than being an assistant government leader. But assistant government leaders, the experience as an assistant government leader is something which I would recommend to everyone. Take that experience for a few years, because such a wide variety of work, diverse subjects. And then it's like a judge, we get all our cases the initial day. Similarly, as an assistant government leader, they give you any number of cases any day. So someday you're handling 5 matters, someday 25 cases, and you are supposed to be ready with it by the next day.
Very true.
So by the next day, you have to be ready with a subject which you may have never dealt with. So then you have to find out the law, read it, be prepared by the next day. So then you learn to be fast. And of course, you learn to work hard, because otherwise you can't deal with so many cases at all.
So,
being a good assistant government leader is also tough. So, but judging is much more difficult.
Rather difficulty, it's a responsibility, great responsibility on judges.
No, it's a lot of hard work. It's a lot of hard work to give a good judgment. A proper judgment which deals with everything. It's a lot of hard work.
It's responsibility. Which judges bear on their shoulders. Very true, madam.
Of course.
Madam, what changes do you foresee after this lockdown period gets over in the entire legal profession?
Actually, basically, what changes could I accept? Except that there might be more use of technology. I don't think, what other changes could you expect? This is social distancing till you need to maintain it. Otherwise, going back to the courts, I think it would be more or less the same. Could you just suggest on what kind of difference do you mean?
Changes would be multiple, madam. Then changes would be on the burden of the courts now, because it's been too...
Of course, burden of the court will be immense, because after such a big gap where the judges are not working, the pressure on the judges will be immense.
So
one thing with advocates is another thing is, which I would like to suggest is, please don't waste the time of the court. Because when you come unprepared, then you keep on flipping through papers. Any query that is asked, you need to consult your client, or then you need time. And then you waste a lot of quotas. Now the situation will be such that there'll be such a huge backlog. And the problem is the number of judges is also very less. Gujarat High Court, I think we have 28 judges. Two will retire by the end of May, two more.
Yes.
So there'll be only half the strength, sanction strength. So with a few judges and so many, each judge has got 200 cases, 300 cases to deal with. So how do you deal with so many cases? So it's going to be very tough, at least that way. But
thank you so very much, madam, for spending time with me this evening. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. It's my pleasure. Okay. Thank you.